Okay, I think we're all in here. Who's going to get in here for now? So welcome to another one of our mind-blowing lectures at the Arthur C. Clarke Center for Human Imagination. I'm Sheldon Brown, the director of the Clarke Center, and thrilled to have here tonight Bruce Sterling and Jasmina Tešanović, who are going to be talking. Was that even in the ballpark? You know, so she coached me a little bit on how to pronounce it. It's probably the 12th way I've pronounced it. they've been here in the Clarke Center the last few weeks in a residency where we've been undertaking a project in what you would call the field of design fiction. And this project came about, Bruce was on a panel for the Clarke Center at our event that we do annually at the Smithsonian called The Future Is Here. And we had a panel on how to design the future. And on that panel was Bruce, along with Vint Cerf, who was one of the co-inventors of TCP/IP and can rightly claim to be an inventor of the internet, and Fiona Raby, who's a leading figure in speculative design and design fiction. And in that panel, we had a question that was, I think, both really simple and of course turned out to be very complex, which was the question of, can we design the future? And the response was pretty much along the lines of, well, when you put it that way, of course not. At least not in the ways that tend to turn out the ways that we want them to. Because humans in our future are very complex and unpredictable things. And probably the only futures that we can, you know, pretty predictably design are ones that are pretty terrible and that we don't want to be a part of. And we've got a lot of historical attempts that seem to back up that approach. If you look at a lot of the 20th century, it's kind of riddled with a number of them. Yet here are three people on this panel whose work seemed to me was all about designing the future. And I wanted to get a better sense from them how fields such as design, art, science fiction, and technology invention interacted with each other in shaping our imaginations to allow us to see possible paths that we might head out on to get to whatever future we might end up at. And so at that conference, Bruce suggested that we might work on a project on living in a more robotic future some 25 years down the road, which as a kind of experiment in design futures. And that time frame both sounded like an awfully long time to think about with the wonders that we seem to be rapidly inventing, but also not that long a time from now, if we think about how long a time some things seem to take to get here. And the safest thing to say when you're kind of thinking about these time frames is that something technological, social, or cultural will occur in this time frame that will not have been thought about at all, and ultimately be one of the kind of most important trends that shapes that unknown future 25 years from now. But so one of the things, and I know Bruce is going to talk about this in probably more with more eloquence and insight than I am here, but if we just think about like this proposition of 25 years in the future, and we think about, you know, where we've come in the last 25 years, so what is that, 1991? What was different then from our time now? And what was unanticipated? You know, 25 years ago, we just had the internet was in a very nascent form. It wasn't widespread, but it wasn't widely used, even though it was, you know, geographically widespread. But things, the general ways we even use the internet, like the World Wide Web, was a kind of an emerging protocol at that time, And it wasn't even the dominant one. Most people were using something called Gopher. And you know, how many people use Gopher today? Yeah. there's still some true believers. And if we think about that time and how World Wide Web, you know, certainly obliterated in the use of something like Gopher. A decade before that, you know, we didn't have MS-DOS. We had IBM searching around for an operating system, and they wanted to buy this thing called CPM. And we'd be, you know, still having legacies of CPM on our equipment today if the person who was kind of in running the CPM operating system decided he wanted to take his plane out for a joyride the day IBM came visiting. So these things that kind of seem to be kind of small inflections on the history's course end up having huge unthought of outcomes. And at the time we also didn't have things that, you know, these ubiquitous smartphones that seem to have changed everything about our kind of social and cultural lives right now. But we did have fantasies about things like communicators and tricorders and ubiquitous, omniscient, disembodied computers that helped us explore strange new worlds and seek out new life and new civilizations. So there's been this always these relationships between the space of speculation, the space of design. And so with Bruce and Jasmina here, we've been undertaking a design fiction task with a bunch of art students, and in particular with that strange mix of students that we try to breed here that mix art and technology innovation. And take on this idea of a design fiction about the future. And I think even that term itself is a kind of interesting term to contemplate, you know, because it's kind of got built-in contradictions in it. Design as a methodology of solving problems, fiction maybe as a methodology of exposing problems. And with that kind of contradiction, for me it starts to enter into the space of art making. And art making kind of adds another kind of dimension around problems, and art usually is about problem making or problematizing. And so you have these kind of different dynamics around the question of the problem. And so design fiction, I think, has this interesting, carves out this interesting space between all of these places. And it might be the practice that has a particular necessity of our particular moment as we think that in 25 years we can't possibly imagine that future because it's going to be so extraordinarily different because our technologies develop so rapidly. But that's a question we always want to keep in mind in this process of thinking about innovation, design, technical, social, and cultural development is a worthwhile thing to try to put together into a pot and see what kind of dish comes out the other side. So Bruce, as many of you probably know, a science fiction author and now a design theorist, is acknowledged as one of the founders of the cyberpunk movement in cyber fiction, in science fiction, and has won, you know, the all the awards, the Hugo, the Campbell, and most importantly the Clarke Award, the only one that really counts, And he's been a visionary in residence at Art Center College in Pasadena recently, and with Jasmina has created Casa Jasmina in Turin, Italy. So Jasmina is an author, political activist, and filmmaker. Her book, The Invisible Book, became a manifesto for alternative Serbian feminist pacifist culture. Diary of a Political Idiot, a war diary written during the NATO bombing of Yugoslavia, was widely distributed and influential on the internet, and as a peace activist, she was a co-winner of the Hiroshima Prize for Peace and Culture. So we'll hear from Jasmina first about Casa Jasmina, and then Bruce will talk to us some more about design fiction. So, Jasmina.
Right, well, now comes the exciting part of seeing if we can use our PC audio-visual system here. Oh, here he goes. All right. It's going to take two of us. All righty. And it's PowerPoint too, which is super exciting. Okay, we're doing two entirely different presentations today. Let's see. Can I open that? Why am I not showing up?
You want me to do it?
If you would, we're begging for help suddenly. There we go. No, that's mine. Why are we not on the screen? There we go, almost, except that it's the wrong slideshow. I need Yasmina's and not mine. Good thing I'm up here, baby. I can make troubles no one else can. There we go. Okay. Yeah, so we have two entirely different presentations because our appearance tonight is about houses of the future and design fiction. And in fact, we have a house of the future, which is Casa Jasmina at the Arduino office, the open source house of the future in Turin, Italy. So Jasmina's going to tell us about this project now. Have at it.
Okay. Hello. Do you hear me? Yes. Usually, I'm not a native English speaker, and when I speak publicly, I speak with a German accent. I don't know why. I hope you understand me. So, my name is Jasmina, and I'm going to speak about the present, actually. It's not about the future. I'm not a futurist. I'm not a designer. I'm not, I'm just a person whose idea it was to make a connected house of the future, in present, basically. And it's supposed to be a private house, and I'm going to tell you how it all started, you know, because I call it a smart house for even smarter people. And the founders of this Casa Jasmina in Torino, Italy, are, actually it was my idea, a private idea, and Bruce Sterling is the curator of this, he's my husband. And there is Massimo Banzi, the third one, who is the one of the founders of Arduino, you know, and he was the one who really liked the idea and who named this idea as by my name, you know. So this is how it's called, Casa Jasmina. How it all started. Bruce and I, we've been living in Italy, you know, we are nomads, we call ourselves globalistas, we don't like private property, we didn't have a house of our own, a home of our own, we've been traveling all over the world, you know, and it felt really good, you know, we're old, we don't care anymore for stuff, any kind of stuff, you know, you inherit, it's always some kind of something, a burden more than, you know, when your parents die, the children go out of the house. And we live that way on the road all the time. But there was a certain moment in Torino, and Torino is this beautiful city in northern Italy, the first capital of Italy, you know, the town of Mama Fiat, as it called it, factory of Fiat, you know. And Mama Fiat, they call it because it gave food to all Italy. You know, it was the first industrial movement of trade unions and everything. It was really, you know, a big deal in the 60s, in the 70s. And all of a sudden, with the collapse in the 2000 and the general economic crisis in 2008, Torino got empty. 30% of its population left. So this city, it's a little bit like, has a history a little bit like Detroit you have in US, you know. So you have this wonderful structure, wonderful buildings, abandoned spaces, you know. And they were just there, sitting there. And we thought like, why don't we take one of these spaces, you know, and just do a house of our dreams, you know, of imagination, completely free, like start from a scratch. We don't really need anything. We can be inventive, you know. And this idea, IoT, it's always like around us, and we were always hanging around with Fab Lab Torino, which is one of the first Fab Labs in Italy and the biggest and the most important. Next to Arduino, we're sleeping with Arduino, you know, where Arduino is made with this brilliant young people come and they're unemployed or self-employed. They either refuse to work for the big companies because they're not productive enough, not inventive enough, or either it's a huge unemployment, you know, in Italy. So they hang out there and they're just inventing stuff, you know, and doing stuff, whatever crosses the mind. And there is also co-working space, toolbox, other kind of crowd which are trying to make a new business model for these new ideas. Anyway, in this space, which is once used to be a big factory constructed by an architect, a famous architect who made bridges in Italy, and then afterwards it was a Fiat warehouse, and then it was abandoned for 30 years, and it's really pretty and falling apart, and, you know. And I said, like, look, there is this space. Why don't we go there? It didn't have windows. You know, there were rats. There were pigeons. It was really cold, you know, but there was internet, you know, this is like really important. So Bruce and I, we slept on the floor, you know, And we try to see un po', yeah, I'm speaking Italian, to see a little bit how the space works out for us. And we really loved it. Of course, there were trains, there were the pigeons, but we said, look, we can really give it a try. And so we started working on it with these people, you know, starting from scratch without money. Because you see, we also didn't want to commit to big sponsors or any big companies, you know, because one of the things is about Internet of Things, about which I'm thinking all the time, it's already here, you know, and it's controlled by big companies, by the big famous five, you know. Instead, what we have to do, we as citizens who are using it, I don't like the word users, I don't want the word client, you know, I want to say that it's only people who live there, and we have to be smarter, and we don't have to be, you know, allow them to control us. So we have to invent everything and to see which of these Internet of Things are really necessary for domotica, for everyday life, because many of these things are just, let's say, some science fiction. I'm not against science fiction, sorry, but I'm just saying, like, many of these things we don't really need. They're just like something for, but many of things we do need, and you don't have to be technically literate in order to understand that certain things really changed, revolutionized our lives, you know, in the 20th century with technology. And so I kind of was thinking about how to make it more down to earth and make it more practical and try to invent or think about this space in a different way. And I realized all of a sudden that there were no women around, you know, like there were no children around. You know, I was sitting there with brilliant kids because they're half my age and they could be, you know, they come from Politecnico. And let's say that the Italian society is very male-centered, you know, when it comes to technology. So I thought, like, you know, we should do something about that. You know, first of all, I must speak to these women. I must find where are the women and speak to them. So I thought of, since I'm not a designer or anything like that, I started speaking to the girls who were sitting around, let's say, the space and brainstorming and to see if they had any different idea about Internet of Things. Because if they're not present, you know, there must be some reason for that. And actually, I came up with seven ways of Internet of Women things, which are different. We wrote this manifesto. We had workshops. And just let me tell you this, that the guys who were hired by Casa Jasmina, now we have a staffers and everything, they're of course all men, and they call themselves Jasmini. You know, they have the male version of my name, you know, but they're which is like really flattering, but that doesn't mean that they can think like women. So my seven approaches that I found out speaking to these women and doing workshops, and let's say that these women come from all backgrounds. So some are artists, some are in IoT, some are Arduino girls, some are, you know, just women, you know, hanging around, let's say, wives, because very often I would say, why don't you ask your wife, you know, what is this thing that you're making there in our lab, is it really necessary and how it should work, you know. So the first approach, I realized that the girls have this approach of critical approach to the design, you know, because for centuries men were only there made, you know, were doing all the technological stuff. So the girls were usually speaking about how certain things were not made for the how. Yes,
you'll have to whip it through your seven approaches.
Yes, I'll whip it.
Yeah.
Okay. The second one was like they had a lot of privacy issues. So most of the time they were like saying, we don't really need the internet. We need privacy. You know, we need to be excluded. And after, of course, the political Snowden case and all that, it really makes sense, you know. And they were also liked a lot of design fiction, inventing things, meaning taking something from your inheritance, like your grandma's clock or something that you like emotionally, and then making it like smart and connected to the house. Then we had like, they also speak a lot about positive seclusion and positive inclusion, which are also political things, but anyway, I'm whipping through it. But what I think is the most important is this cultural differences that they notice. Meaning, if we do Casa Jasmina in Torino, it's going to be Italian, you see. And what's the, I think, the secret of our success, that it is a success after 2 years, we'll tell you at the end what we did there, is that Bruce comes from this you know, kind of background of a high-tech person, and he knows everything like Silicon Valley. And I come from a war zone. But you know the joke that how long does it take for a woman to change a bulb, that kind of stuff. Well, I not only had to learn how to change a bulb, I had to learn how to make a bulb, because otherwise there is no electricity. So this kind of maker thing, you know, that do it yourself, and this kind of high-tech found its kind of common ground in the middle. And I think the cultural differences that determine are very, very important to determine the success of some of these devices that we're inventing and making in Casa Jasmina. Because not the most successful, not the most smart, not the most intelligent, not the prettiest will have success, but something that people accept in their everyday lives. Meaning you, not user, not clients, but people like children, old people, who are really in need of technology, of this new way of communicating with soft robots, but they don't want intruders. They don't want something to intrude on them. You know, this is very important. So after 2 years of you know, this drill, the drill is invented by a woman, you know. One of the most famous drills was actually designed by a woman from Milano. I found it only recently. So it's not like a stunt. Anyway, after 2 years, I must say that we really met success, because we had all the community coming to us. There is also the makers movement, which is growing rapidly in Italy. It's becoming revolutionary, really. Because you see, the entire Italy is a country of artisans, you know, of people who are, and it collapsed economically. You know, this is also a political project, you know, because this way is a way of making some kind of new political and economic model of survival after the crisis. Young people are unemployed, like people cannot afford to buy a new kitchen, a new stuff, but young people can make their own stuff through the makers movement, through open source, which is very important politically speaking, because we're an open source like Arduino is. You must know what Arduino is, you know, I don't want to explain to you, but that's very important that it's open source. And also, we came up with this definition, we call it open source lusso, because Italy is a country of design, and it has this really want and really need, an obsessive need of beauty, you know, which I appreciate, you know. On the other hand, if you combine it with open source, it means that we can share this, let's say personal or personalized design. So you don't go to IKEA and buy stuff, you know, which everybody has, but you can open source it and you can design it and you can redesign it. So I think that in that sense, Italy is the best country for that. And we had also our yearly share festival, it's called Electronic Art Festival. This year, it is, since we curated together and we're in the jury, this year we brought it to Casa Jasmina, meaning we wanted it to be art for the home. It's an open call. So artists really design send us projects like this one. This was an art and
explain the project.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Okay, I won't explain the project. But anyway, you're showing the photos. However, stop talking to me. However, I wanted to say that at the end of our workshops, we came up with quite a few things of Internet of Women things, which I'm very proud. One of them is Goodnight Lamp by Alexandra Duchamp, Sonsino Duchamp. We don't have the picture. Anyway, it's a little house and a big house, and this is the little and the big house communicate with itself via Internet. So if you have a child or you have a mom somewhere else on the other side of the world, you don't use the intrusive SMS texts. You know, it's always some kind of attention. Somebody sends you something and you have to answer. This is just, it lightens up, you know, and it gives you this feeling of emotional presence. We're alive, even with another part of the world. Then we have the idea of augmented reality refrigerated. Faisa, a woman from Torino, a Moroccan designer from Torino, is making this augmented reality refrigerator, which is very practical. I won't go into detail. It's not just augmented reality. It really tells you what you need to know about what's inside your fridge. And I also have this idea about making a smart laundry line. You know, laundry is very important. We don't have dryers. We use, in Italy, laundry is always put up outside. And you know, people invest a lot of money in their laundry. You know, I mean, stuff. Why should it be hidden? It should be set up outside, and it should be somehow controlled as a sculpture. And we have a hammam in Casa Jasmina, which is now being designed by a workshop of architects. And you know, in Italy, these architects did not know anything about IoT, and they were kind of afraid of it. But once we explained, and once we showed them that we have this big lab, fab lab, and we have the robots down there, and we have the makers, and we have these brilliant guys who will teach them how to make something out of those ideas they just have, it's becoming a hit, you know, and we're finishing that. Now, what is the future of Casa Jasmina? And here I'm ending. The future of Casa Jasmina, really, we don't know. After 2 years, we decided anyway to finish it when we started planning it. So we had an exit plan, ending it up after 2 years. And after 2 years, it's becoming really a bed and breakfast because it's going to open as a bed and breakfast. So people are going to come and stay there and give their own ideas and their own, let's say advisors, or if they're artists or designers, they're gonna design something for Casa Jasmina. So basically you're all invited and welcome, you know, it's an open space still for you. Then it has this museum side to it, that all of a sudden they started inviting us people from London Museum, the Vitra people came to do this, that now Bruce is gonna talk about, that Sheldon talked about. Then we have Ars Electronica. We were selected as one of the most interesting projects for Ars Electronica, which is an artistic, most important artistic festival of electronic art in Europe, you know. And then we will have also a show in Makers Fair Rome, which is colossal. It became colossal, you know. It had like how many 100,000 people, and this year it has a huge prize for the best maker object, and we will have our own exposition and space where Casa Jasmina will basically be redone in a little bit less space by younger some young artists and some young makers, and also we will carry out the idea. So basically this is it. And you know, sometimes, as I was saying to somebody before I came up, I say sometimes you have these wonderful ideas and nothing comes up and they never work. And sometimes you have this really private thing and it becomes really important because people think it's important, they catch up and they help you deliver, and you know, it grows in the world. We will have Casa Gerta in Germany. There is also people who want to do it in London. So hopefully we have one also in California. Thank you.
Okay. That is great, man.
Oh, okay, she's killing it. All right, can I get my slides up here? There we go. Yeah. You wonder, okay, you know, you're a science fiction writer, you're like interested in design, you know, what can you do to affect the future? Why don't you just go out and build something, right? And we in Torino, we have the capacity to do that. People asked us to do it, and we got quite involved in this project. But I'm not going to talk about Casa Jasmina because it's all on online, casajasmina.arduino.cc. You can look us up. There's ton of stuff going on there. Jasmina could have gone on for a week. We do go on for a week. It's a social center. People are in there messing with new stuff every day. It's very happy. We're very happy about it. It's not going to change the world by itself, but it is a moral gesture on our part, and we were happy about it. So, you know, what are we doing here, or what am I doing here? Well, this is you. I mean, this is why you're on my radar. This is UCSD with a new major in speculative design, and I'm exceedingly keen on speculative design. So I'm going to like give you a pitch about it and sort of where I think it's coming from. So if you think you might be interested in speculative design, design fiction, critical design, this is the book you want to read first and probably last. This is Speculative Everything by Anthony Dunn and Fiona Raby. And Fiona Raby was here when you opened your speculative design major, so that's a sign you're being blessed by the great dame of critical design. And this book is, I don't know, 3 or 4 years old now, maybe even older, but there's never been a better book written on the subject. So you can read this, and if you think, oh, this is just like weird British design school theory stuff, I don't get it at all, then critical design is not for you, and go do something else. But that's a really good book. I mean, it's their masterpiece. And this is them. This is Tony Dunn and Fiona Raby. And this is a list they made some years ago, which compares industrial design, or kind of standard design, to critical design. So critical design's on the right. And you can see that it's not doing the sort of thing that design does, doing a bunch of other stuff. It's wordy, but so am I. I'm not really a designer. I mean, in fact, I'm not a designer at all. I'm not even that interested in design. What really interests me is design theory. I really like design theory, and I take like design theorists with deadly seriousness, and I'm kind of one of them myself. So if you're a design, I'm like a design fiction critic. I don't do a lot of it, but I'm like keen to assess what's going on there. So if you're a critic, you have to like come up with some critical armature to like try and give a theoretical form to what's going on. So this is one of my interventions. This is the anti-conventional objects diagram. And it's mostly there to loosen up and kind of free and lubricate people's understandings about the difference between real objects and speculative objects. All right, okay, well, we happen to live in a capitalist society. So our conventional objects have to make money, and somebody has to want them, and we have to be able to make them. So they have to be desirable, buildable, and profitable. But most objects don't fit in the conventional objects area. You know, most of them aren't real. They're imaginary, or they're mythical, or magical, or whatever. So I just went out of my way to, like, show the haze of objects that are outside the world of conventional objects. And there's really lots. And not only that, but these circles move around quite a lot, so that stuff that used to be profitable no longer is, or things that were not buildable become buildable, or things that were desirable lose their cachet and people don't want them anymore. So the little brown area in the center is actually remarkably unstable. It tends to like fall apart, and the mere fact that it's real and kind of offered on a shelf at Walmart does not make it a permanent part of the universe. Then there's this other thing I wrote, which is rather similarly wordy, because I'm a writer. But this is the design fiction slider bar of disbelief, which shows that we never really know the absolute and unobtainable objective truth about objects and services. I mean, we just don't. I mean, that's metaphysics. We can't absolutely know that, for instance, this water bottle is somehow better than this water bottle. I mean, we can't know its entire history and so forth. But, you know, we can write about it, and we can kind of try to understand it. We can kind of come up to some kind of consensus about it. And then it gets slowly more hazy as things get less and less, and then they sort of begin drifting off into a wonderland of fairy stories, magic, vague religious notions. Like, everybody knows what the hammer of Thor is, but what are the industrial design specifications for the hammer of Thor? Right? And this is like actually like a problem. And when you become aware of like these shady areas, is where you can do good design fiction interventions. You can begin to play these kinds of suspension of disbelief games where you make the implausible plausible and so forth. So, you know, design fiction is not a form of fiction, like science fiction is a genre of fiction. Design fiction is actually a form of design. It's a form of design that has an audience rather than users or consumers. So it's presented as if it were fiction, but it's actually at its best when it's close to the borders of reality, when you really can't tell the real from the imaginary, and when the practitioner is deliberately playing games with that. So this is a diagram I just made up after enjoying the hospitality of the Clarke Center. We're in there building some design objects for a robot house of the future, and our patron is Vitra Design Museum, who's commissioned us to do some design fiction. So we're in there building imaginary objects from 25 years in the future, and in order to do that and to present it to the public, they have to make sense, they have to be legible. I mean, you have to look at them, and they have to have some kind of meaning. They need to look attractive so that people don't just walk away. I mean, you're doing a museum installation, so you want people to see it. And we have to be able to physically build it, or at least fake it virtually. And I can promise you that the buildable part is absolutely the hardest part. I mean, it's a common thing now to say that people can build anything. You know, it's just like, oh, well, we've got 3D printing and all this cool stuff. We can kind of make anything we want, and it's kind of easy, and hardware is not hard anymore. It's not true. Hardware is very hard. I mean, I hang out with maker guys. I know a lot of guys who are doing this kind of Kickstarter-style, conjectural, building things. They're like making things from virtual plans or doing open-source hardware projects. It's still exceedingly difficult. You hang out with these guys, they've always got scars on their hands. They're like harming themselves in there. I mean, even if you watch a master of special effects, working on these objects, you can see that even making fake objects is quite a difficult craft. And, you know, and design earns my respect in that way, because, you know, I know how hard it is just to give form to objects, even an imaginary form to objects. To make it look good is quite difficult and really requires a lot of skill. So now I'm going to go through some of the people who I think can really do this. And if you're interested in speculative design or design fiction, these are people who are either your colleagues or your mentors. And sooner or later, you're going to run into them anyway. So if you think you would want to indulge yourself in this world or go out and contribute something, you would be wise to figure out who these guys are and kind of like get up to speed with them. Okay, this is Near Future Laboratory. Great friends of ours. That's Julian Bleeker, Nick Foster to the left. Well, you can look up Near Future Laboratory online. They've written a lot of manifestos. They've done all kinds of catalogs. They've been at it for 10, 11 years. They are Californian. Julian teaches at USC, I think it is. He's an electrical engineer. They've done a lot of the heavy lifting for design fiction. Julian was probably the inventor of the term. And Nicholas Nova here, who teaches at HEAD in Switzerland, is a very capable theoretician. So Near Future Laboratory, guys I take very seriously. This is Nelly Ben-Hayoun. Nelly the Hammer Ben-Hayoun, Seizing the Microphone at South by Southwest Interactive, a real spark plug design fiction performance artist. Her specialty is hanging around with big science and high technology. Nelly's an experiential designer. She comes up with situations. And she has a unique practice, which really takes her all over the world. She's one of the students of Dunn and Raby, and really one of the star students of Dunn and Raby. A dynamo of a woman. What she gets up to and the trouble she can make in a matter of weeks is a wonder. This is Alexandra Daisy Ginsburg, who's another student of Dunn and Raby from the Royal College of Art. She does a lot of conceptual work in synthetic biology. Very capable person in that. Really knows a lot about it and is an intimate with genuine scientists, understands journalism, is just extremely well briefed in this area where she does her design fictions. And, you know, appears in museums and does books and magazine spreads, you know, a very capable practitioner, even though she never makes, quote, real products. She actually does things that, like, have a public impact. I mean, she's really kind of an adept of the human imagination with, you know, a deep understanding of the area of science that she's trying to illuminate, problematize, fictionalize. This is a group called Next Nature Network. I noticed that your speculative design group is in your visual arts department. And these are visual artists, actually. This is Mika Gerritsen and her husband. Kurt von Menswort, and their Dutch colleagues who have put together this a series of conferences, a website, a number of books, some videos, and other kinds of interventions. And, you know, and Mika is a very well-known graphic designer, and they write about the future of nature and kind of genetically modified organisms and what the natural world might look like in a 25 or 30 year period, climate change, robotics, a lot of similar topics and themes. And they are visual artists, and they've actually kind of made, I wouldn't call it a business exactly, but it's like an avocation. I mean, you can belong to their group, you can shop, you can attend their events, they're what you would call, speculative design professionals who happen to be visual artists. So if you are a visual artist and you thought, by golly, you know, I'm going to do me some of this speculative design, the instant question is sort of like, okay, what do I do with it now that I've got some? They've actually got, I think, a better idea of how to comport themselves than most other people. I mean, who's the audience? Our audience is a design museum. Vitra Design Museum are the people who have brought us here. And I think that's rather typical. I mean, there's the New York Museum of Modern Art where they've been quite friendly toward design fiction. There's a science museum in Dublin that does a lot of work. Or you can work for special effects companies. You can work for industrial groups. You can do videos. But, design fiction as a career is a thing that's sort of between design and fiction, and neither of them are ways to make $1 million really fast, unless you're at the 1% who's like the best rewarded. But Next Nature is tackling this. This is Stuart Candy and Chris Wopkin and one of their colleagues in OCAD in Canada. They're doing their design fiction. Stuart Candy's probably the world's best known practitioner of what's called experiential design fiction, which is where you make up an environment full of objects and services from the future and just have people immerse themselves in it. In other words, you build a room or a set, and you say, behind this door, it's 2025 AD, and you're about to walk in there. Try not to be nervous. And then he hires actors, and he invents all these props, and he literally brings people into these experiences and has them go through it. It can be remarkably effective. I mean, you walk through one of these doors, you know, it's sort of like costume play or these other kinds of science fiction convention activities where everybody's pretending to be a vampire. It's just better put together, right? And it can be like seriously disorienting because everybody's talking just as they normally do and kind of going about their business. And it really feels like time travel. This is a project they did in Canada, which was called the 99 Cent Project, where they got a bunch of designers and students together to make very cheap, humble objects of the future, the kind of things you get out of a vending machine 20 or 30 years from now. And those are all these little plastic wrap things sitting on the table. Every one of those is some kind of design fiction intervention that these guys created. And then when you're like sitting at the table and kind of going through these, it's like visiting the 99 cent store, except everything is, yeah, everything has some kind of frisson to it, you know? It all has, they're all diegetic prototypes and they all suspend disbelief. So you may ask, you know, what becomes of me in doing this? Do I do a lot of this? It's like, actually, no. I mean, I hang out with them. I find their activities really interesting. I'm a booster of design fiction. I don't really do a lot of design fiction myself. But I have found that my association with design has, changed my own practice in profound ways. And this is a short story of mine, which you can see came out last month. It's pretty recent. It's a brief piece, but it's about the old-fashioned, rather old-fashioned science fiction idea of people with superhuman powers, human augmentation, we might call it now. So it's a story which is told from the point of view of a guy undergoing human augmentation, but it's all related in the way that an industrial designer or a technician or a startup company would do it. It's not surrounded with the sci-fi haze of Marvel Comics. On the contrary, everything's very toned down and just presented from really a more of a critical design perspective. And it has, I think, a quite a powerful effect. And one of the main reasons I became interested in design fiction was my awareness that the objects and services in science fiction were too dramatic. I mean, they were fictional, and they were meant to get some kind of response, and most of them were power fantasies. They tend to be things like laser swords, blasters, time machines, super artificial intelligences, just dramatic and exciting things that look good on the likes of Twilight Zone, and they didn't really do well when compared with genuine objects and services which had been built to standards of industrial design. So I began to, exercise some of the tricks of industrial design in science fiction, whenever I put an artificial object or service into a story, I think about it from a design perspective first, and I think that's really changed the tenor of stories, and it gives them like a kind of strength and a convincing quality that they would not have if they had more of the kind of blood and thunder of pulp sci-fi. So I have not abandoned science fiction. I'm still at it. I've got like a new book here. And, you know, this is like my new American book, and it's like fun, little diesel punk book. And, you know, my infatuation with design hasn't really harmed my fondness for science fiction at all. I found that it kind of grounds me in some ways. And what I sort of really appreciate about my about my encounter with design is the ability to sort of go in and mix it up with the grain of the material, right? I mean, I actually learn things from sort of going right next to the drill press, you know, from sort of putting on the ear protectors, from smelling the burning laser dust, you know. It grounds me in a way that I didn't have before, and it kind of gives my engagement with fantasy more of a sense of authority. So, I don't like to repeat myself as a writer, and I've been at it for quite a long time. So I have to look pretty far afield to see stuff I've never seen before. But design fiction actually reveals a lot of that stuff to me. And it reveals it in the kind of gritty detail that actually captures my imagination now. I find that it rejuvenates me. I'm always happy when I'm in a room with design fiction people or open source hardware people. When I'm in a room, it's just full of people half my age, talking as fast as they can about stuff I don't understand. I feel like I'm in the right place for me. So that's why I have been here. And that's what we've been doing for a few weeks. So thank you for your attention. And we can take some questions now. I'll show you one of the artifacts from our weeks of effort here. They're still as as Sheldon would point out, yeah, they're still half baked. But this is a futurist quadrant for a future soft robotic home. Let's move to the table here. Are our mics live?
We're getting there. No, we need the mics.
No, that's good. It's Vice, but it's Vice's website, the new one.
Motherboard.
Yeah, this is motherboard.vice.com. I've written a couple of stories for Motherboard, actually. I'm quite taken with their freaky little scene there. Or you could just look it up. Come on, David. Google the silly thing.
He's fast.
They're clever. Come on. This is freaking UCSD. They've got a high scholastic aptitude in here. I'm sure they could find this silly story if they feel like it.
Where can they find out more about you, both of you?
We're kind of underground figures, okay? We're cyberpunks, you know? If you don't know by now, don't ask would be some good advice there.
So I guess we're here just to take some questions of other people.
We're working on an installation for Vitra Design Museum. They're doing a show next year on the future of robotics in the home. So Amelie Klein from Vitra came to Casa Jasmina, and she was hanging out with us in our open source House of the Future. And she said, I have a House of the Future problem, and it involves robots, and can you help us with it? And, Jasmina and I kind of stared at her and said, well, you know, we don't think we can do anything of European museum quality, but we have been to the Smithsonian Museum, and we see they're on quite good terms with the Clarke Center. So, you know, perhaps we can arrange something here. And, you know, a few months later, indeed, here we are. That's the story.
Yeah, and I think, you know, one of the things I was talking about early is this kind of space of design fiction and how it relates to these, you know, kind of things that we used to do. And, you know, so I look at something like Casa Jasmina, and to me, you know, the primary antecedent of that is all this performance art that was happening in, you know, the last, you know, 50 years, and to people who, you know, art as life, and, you know, performance artists whose life was their artwork. And so that to me is what where I see, you know, Casa Jasmina.
Absolutely. I don't know if I said it, because I think we live there. The fact that we live there, and, you know, other people come, and we make parties, and we cook, and we have the garden, and we, you know, this kind of different, you know, because stuff determines, I mean, the things you have determine your lifestyle. you know? Yeah. I mean, like, you can't live in a different way if you have the old place, you know? This is like, and this is, I think, yeah, life is art. That was the from the 70s, and now we do maybe even the opposite, you know?
So it's what's exciting to me then is that, you know, this field starts to, it starts to get called something. You know, there start to be people that you refer to and become kind of points of, you know, definition of a kind of area of conceptual practice. And and as Bruce talks about, for him, it kind of is a way to, that seems to be a transformation of what's at stake for him as a writer. I think it's also transforms what's at stake for art and hopefully what's at stake for design. And that's pretty compelling when you start to bring three very different things together like that.
Yeah, it's the mix and match aspects of it that actually wake me up quite a lot. You know, and it would have been easy to write a story about an open source hardware home, because I know a lot of guys in open source hardware. I used to be a columnist for Make magazine, and you know, it would not be difficult for me to write a sci-fi parody or a rhapsody or any kind of fictional thing you wanted to do. But the fact that we actually like eat, sleep there, and like pick plywood splinters out of our hands, actually makes it a different kind of social experience. You know, and people come in and like mess with us. And, you know, I mean, then engineers are there, and, coders are there, and 3D print guys are there, and the maker scene is there. But the fact that it is a house, you know, in this derelict factory also brings in poets and architects and politicians and people who we would never have met and who would never have come into our cultural orbit if we didn't actually have this center, right? I mean, it's like the difference between having an Arthur Clarke Center for Imagination and just reading a lot of Arthur Clarke and trying to imagine some stuff, you know, which in fact I did. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I read plenty of Arthur Clarke, practically everything the guy ever wrote. I met him. I got all my books autographed. I get new material from mixing it up with people who have some skin in the game, really. I mean, just sort of being there. You know, and I think Arthur would say the same thing. I mean, he used to write about space, but he also went out skin diving with Wernher von Braun. You know, he would actually go, and he would write nonfiction as well as fiction. He didn't spend all his time in dreamland and orbit. On the contrary, he liked to get down and dirty with the guys who were standing next to the benzene on the launch pad. And I think that's a valuable life lesson.
There was a question back there.
Yeah, just number them off. Your seven principles of the IOWT. Yes,
okay, you see?
No, she was reciting them. She just didn't number them. Yeah, she's got a manifesto.
I have a manifesto. So first one is critical design, you know, through technology, as I mentioned. The second one is positive inclusion, because really, I mean, a great percentage, I mean, in Italy, it's like 5% of women are there, so they want to have just physically women there. And then positive seclusion, that women...
That's three.
That when they live alone, they want to... they work alone, they think in a different way. Privacy control, they don't want
That's
to be
four.
Connected. And then there is the fifth one, which says just do it. We don't want to be mentioned at all as women, as gender. You know, I mean, exclusion from the gender. And then there is design fiction. Girls like a lot to do design fiction stories about objects, stories. They like the stories. And then the cultural differences. They notice that the thing that works in Italy would work in Germany, working in US. Okay, that's it.
Right.
He allowed me all seven.
Well, you need to actually number them.
Yeah, well, right. That's it.
Okay. Yeah. Otherwise, people get lost in the torrent there. But there's plenty going on there. I mean, you hang out with the Internet of Women Things group. They all talk like this, and even faster. And in Italian, which is kind of groovy.
More questions from the audience?
Oh, what have we been doing in the lab?
Yeah,
in our lab. Okay, well, we have a Tumblr where the stakeholders in our little design project have been researching exotic forms of robotics for about 6 months now. So I knew a little bit about that because we hang out with Arduino guys. Arduino, as you may know, is an actuator. It's a control board for electronic art. And Jasmina and I are both huge fans of electronic art. We really like installations. And you know, our future home has a big Internet of Things element. So we're very interested in kind of autonomous mobile devices moving around in the home. So we're trying to think 25 years down the way of a kind of alternative soft plush domestic robotics of a kind that doesn't exist now but might be hinted at in things like the Harvard Lab for Soft Robotics. So we were, you know, inventing devices and kind of mocking up little objects there. We managed to build ourselves a pneumatic tentacle. It's going to be kind of the star of the show, in my opinion. We have a couple of small disguised robots that are kind of running around pretending to be soft robots. We've got things we could mock up. But basically, the upshot of this will be an installation or maybe just a little dollhouse where people in the future are going through rituals of their day, you know, just kind of design fiction little moments where children are there, old people are there, and they're just kind of living the life, right? And people will come through the Vitra Design Museum, hopefully, and kind of gaze into this, and they'll basically be voyeurs. And they, you know, and nothing is explained. There's no dialogue. There's no subtext. There's no science fiction. It's meant for people in different societies whose first language isn't English. It's kind of like silent film in a way. So that'll be the upshot. I mean, if it works out, Vitra will pack up this thing, send it around their network of other design museums, and it'll be out on the road for, I don't know, maybe 3 to 5 years. I mean, just depending on kind of the weather and design museum land, whether they can get all their grants, you know, whether the EU holds together. I like design a lot, and I like design theory, which causes me to hang out with design museum curators quite a lot. And my role in design, I mean, Jasmina is the hostess and really the maven of Casa Jasmina, and my role there is to be the curator. I mean, I'm the person who sort of says, let's keep this and let's not keep that. And not keeping that is actually the hard part. Yeah. I mean, the place would just fill up with maker junk in a week if we didn't just kind of try and pitchfork it away. And the same is true of design museums. If you hang out with museum curators, you realize it's not about acquiring stuff. It's about quietly de-accessing things.
And I think that's kind of describes our process, too. I think we created a lot of garbage, and out of that garbage, a few things started to crawl out and kind of demand to stick around, and those things will continue to get some more attention and nurtured, and will probably produce some unexpected offspring here in the next few weeks as we kind of pull this project into form. But it's, you know, it was a, I think the interesting thing, you know, about the project, and for this, you know, it was all these people that were involved were all really from the arts, but you know, all these kind of artists who work with technology and kind of blur that line between technology innovators and artists, and so kind of just looking at kind of laying the conceptual terrain out of which this kind of pile of junk would start to emerge was, you know, really the project for the last few weeks, and thinking about the kind of productive tensions, you know, so as Bruce talked about, you know, these things would be just kind of the things of your daily life, you know, and so these things of your daily life, just like now, if we were back in 1991 and watching everyone carry around these little rectangles of glass that they were constantly looking at the whole time, you know, that might have seemed kind of unusual from that perspective, you know, so in 25 years, what are these kind of typical things that are going to have formal, identifiable formal qualities, are going to have kind of physical engagement with the body and with the and mediate social interaction, and what might be the emerging kind of forms that do that, and how will they change those things, and along what dimensions would it be interesting to explore them, which is this chart that Bruce has here, which kind of starts to lay out some kind of aesthetic dimensions of it.
Yeah, it's you know, you sort of wonder what the upshot of this is. Okay, it's not going to be a revolution and soft robotics. But you know, if Vitra does it and runs it, there's going to be an aspect of Vitra's robot show which is completely divorced from any previous ideas of what robots have been like. I mean, it's really going to be radically different from any kind of
previous paradigms of what it's like to have a robot in your house. And the, you know, the science fiction history of robots dates back to Prague in the 1920s. This is a very, very well-established science fiction trope with just like decades and decades of barnacles all over it. I mean, all kinds of Android is your wife stories and killer wife stories and Dave, I can't let you do that, get away from the pod bay door. You know, it's like everybody knows these shibboleths of robotics. And it's pleasant to have a chance to reimagine it. Oh yeah, golem stories. Okay, we don't have a single robot in here with a head. There's nothing that can talk. There's nothing with arms and legs.
Well, one thing that's very interesting, Bruce, is your life as an expatriate. I know that you've written a story for my upcoming anthology.
I did.
It's sponsored by the Clarke Center. And it's fascinating.
A noble cause.
it's fascinating.
Actually, it's about a house of the future when you think about it. It is a house of the future story. It happens to have Berlusconi in it.
Yeah.
Maybe you could say a few words about Berlusconi's houses. This is going to be pretty good.
Why should I speak about that?
You know all kinds of things about his secret life.
No, I think I should say that five women judges managed to get rid Italy of Berlusconi. You know, they were relentless. You know, but finally, nothing. Even the all the crimes he committed against everybody couldn't help. But then when they started. Anyway, I know Berlusconi because I lived there. I grew up in Milano. I mean, not person, but I know exactly what kind of people and what kind of story was going on there. It's the simple man from the street, the self-made man who expresses all the non-politically correct feelings. Uh-huh. And this is what happened in Serbia with Milosevic, you know, that people could identify. And this is what's going with Trump in U.S., you know, and it's like, I always have this now new theory. I want to write about how political correctness produces these non-politically correct people beyond their, just because they're not political, they become so famous and become so potent, you know. But I wanted to say something about Casa Jasmina, how we were like really this squat. It wasn't a squat, but it was like nothing, you know, and in the part of the city abandoned, you know, and all of a sudden we have these fancy people coming to us. They want to make shows. I have stage fright for them. You know, we have mayors who come to organize stuff there. Now we have UN. As soon as we come back to Europe, I just got the mail this morning, the UN wants to give a party there in our rooms. We have to clean it. We have to bring the glasses. I don't know. I mean, these people are like really, you know, they have, you know, there's a big center of UN in Torino and they have like a lot of money and a lot of power there, you know, and they want to come to Casa Jasmina, you know, we can hardly host 50 people inside, you know, and this is like, but the good side is that people from the neighborhood, because it was kind of an abandoned neighborhood, you know, even though it was very pretty once, and then it is in downtown. It's like parts of LA, which are completely in downtown and abandoned. Now, these people are so happy, and they come with their children, and they come to the Maker's Fair, and they enter Casa Jasmina. And I remember once Bruce and I were like going to bed, you know, and all of a sudden you have them entering our bedroom and say, can we see, please, you know, how is your bed made, you know, is it? And we're like sitting there, you know, like behaving like John and Yoko, you know, like, you know, life is art, you know, never mind,
we
you know.
We have many John and Yoko moments, actually.
Yeah, we had, you know, you just, and I think I like this aspect because these people, when they come inside, you know, they're really precious. You know, because they, especially the children who start deconstructing our inventions, like, you know, playing with them, killing them, or our major goal is not to kill the children. You know, we prefer the children kill our things that we kill the children. But they can be really, you know, as I said, they're not user, they're not clients, they're even post, internet, post everything. And we have our own cloud also. We are thinking about, Giannino made its own cloud. So we were like, we don't want to depend on the Italian state on anything, on fast web, on Google, on anybody, you know? And these kids who are post internet, post everything, they come back, they don't want to play with the computers. They don't want to press the buttons, you know? They take tables and deconstruct them, you know? They just put in pieces and then they construct them again and they connect them in their own ways, and this is what basically how I see the future, because they are present and they are a future. You know, they are kids, you know, grandkids, whatever.
Yeah, I think, you know, the project actually captured the imagination of the Turinese population there. They refer to it commonly as the house of the future or a house of the future. And, you know, and there are quite a few of those. I mean, there's a tradition of those in Italian design, and it's not really that weird to have a thing that you call a house of the future. And it's not weird. It's not weird in an Italian context to have something that's basically a left of center social squat, which is, you know, kind of what Casa Jasmina looks like. I mean, I knew that when we got guests who started hand rolling their own tobacco cigarettes. These guys are squatters, you know. They can't buy their own cigarettes. They have to bring in the paper and the little leather pouch, and they're in. And now everybody in Casa, all the Jasmini, have now picked up this habit. But it fascinates me to see this, you know, run through societies. And I do spend a lot of time as an immigrant, and I live in societies where I don't understand the language and where people's habits are a complete puzzle to me. And I find that it wakes me up, you know. Even though I'm a man in my 60s, when I'm in the likes of Kazakhstan, I'm kind of like an adult 7-year-old. I just have to, like, kind of keep my eyes and ears open and sort of say as little as possible and just kind of watch people's routines. And I find that wakes me from my dogmatic slumbers. I just feel more mentally healthy. I don't repeat myself as much, especially when nobody understands what I say. That's particularly useful. And, you know, we're two married emigres, and under those circumstances, it's actually very, very helpful to live in a third country. So you don't have to be, you know, the exotic arm candy whose last name is hard to pronounce. And I'm that in Serbia. I'm, you know, Boris Sterlink, you know, this is all kind of Boris Rebro. Well, people call me Sterlink, too. That's kind of Bruce. I get a lot of Bruce, you know. And you get used to it. And there's something liberating about it. And also just, you know, a real interest in industrial design helps you understand foreign cultures in a big way, too. It's like, why are there trains like that? Why are there elevators like that? Why are the water faucets like this? You know, and when you can catch on in that way, it actually, you don't feel lost. You can kind of acculturate in a very useful fashion.
I wanted to mention Samantha Cristoforetti, which is the female astronaut who spent most time in outer space, who is now pregnant. Huh? And when she came to Casa Jasmina, and it was like, we were very happy to have her, she was in the Jury of Share Festival, and I spoke to her, and what was she interested? Like, she was interested, even if she's in outer space, she thinks about how she can bring back to the Earth and to a private space the experience she had in the outer space, you know. And this was why she was interested in Casa Jasmina's house of the future, as they call it, but I really call it house of the present, and what can be changed in an everyday life, because when she spends a lot of time really out there, when she comes, she cannot go back to her mom's pasta, you know. And now she's also having a baby, you know, which is like, she's a big icon in Italy, you know, because she has this normal life, you know, a normal life combining the life there and the life here. And this was like really precious to speak to her in that way.
Yeah, she, Paola, you know, Samantha Cristoforetti was kind enough to like join our jury at Share Festival, and so did Paola Antonelli, who's the museum curator at the Museum of, she's the design curator for the Museum of Modern Art in New York. So these two women wanted to meet one another, so we were able to sort of arrange this thing where they came in and helped out our festival and had a public event in Casa Jasmina and in Toolbox co-working. And, you know, the presence of these two Italian women in the Torino, I don't know, digital design scene, the moral effect that they had was just really profound. I mean, it just changed the scene tremendously. I mean, they just, you know, the design maven and an astronaut. I mean, that room was just electric. And it was full of women who had, you know, avoided all these geeks with their punch presses and saw blades for quite a while. And it really changed the tenor of the goings on there, and I think a very healthy way. And I'm grateful to both of them. They're good friends and allies to have.
So another question, maybe a last question from the audience.
More astronauts.
Don, you've been
can't have too
suspiciously
many
quiet
astronauts
over there, Don.
Yeah, oh, he's talking about industrial design, I'm saying. But also, it's dangerous to debate with Bruce. He wins sometimes.
And he always makes money, right?
Okay, let's have a question here. Oh, the pneumatic tentacle is still evolving. We've just blown up version 2 and now rapidly designing version 3.
They have been known to detonate. Yeah, I can reveal that.
That's right. Yeah. But version 3 is going to start to get infused with some genetic algorithm smartness, and so it will start to develop its own kind of uncanny intelligence as it kind of moves forward. But it makes for something that I think, you know, as we started to make these things and then think about, you know, what we would do if we had them, you know, I think I can't wait for my pneumatic tentacles to just give me a nice little, you know, pet every once in a while. And just to kind of, you know, just to make the house feel a little more homey.
Yeah, I think the power of design fiction is in the prototype, you know, as opposed to like telling people even eloquently about what they might do with this, that, or the other object or service. I mean, just like bring out the table full of 99-cent future objects. The moral effect on people is really powerful, right? And it sort of breaks divisions of, you know, gender and society. You don't have to like fast talk anybody or use any of the standard foo-foo-rah of sci-fi exposition. You just put something in their hands that doesn't exist but has weight and mass, you know. And it's not a super powerful effect. I mean, it's kind of like stage magic in some ways, just like pulling off your thumb and eating it. Well, you know, which is okay, it's like great, but you know, You do it twice, and so what?
Isn't one of the charming things about those objects plausible mundanity?
Yeah, you know, there are people who argue that. Nick Foster wrote a pretty good essay on mundane design fiction, where he says about, you know, he makes a case for doing things that have no sense of wonder, or that deflate their own sense of wonder. You know, and in some ways, I mean, that's something that design does. I mean, design tends to be quite unobtrusive and serviceable. Not everything that design does is super fancy and, you know, chrome plated. In fact, as design matured, it tended to remove itself into the background. And you can have good effects like that in science fiction too. I mean, William Gibson talks about atemporality quite a lot, in which in atemporality, instead of glamorizing the novum in your science fiction story, the element of the science fiction story that's novel, you refer to it in a very offhand way, as if it had already been there for 25 years, or if it were somehow down market, or had been forgotten, or eclipsed, or was a thing that was past its sell-by date, right? And that kind of atemporal verbal approach can be very powerful, right? I mean, it's kind of the William Gibson used, you know, what is it? I mean, he's a big fan of the pawn shop theory of sci-fi. He's the gomi no sensei, the master of trash, of innovations kind of described as if they were garbage or as if they'd been forgotten. And, you know, given that we live in a society that tends to relentlessly glamorize innovation, to talk about innovation as if it were old hat or boring can be exciting and paradoxical and powerful. But that's really an issue for literary criticism, not for design criticism.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I happen to be a long-term fan of augmented reality because I like the kind of mixed reality aspects better than I do this kind of multicolored blindfold where your senses are kind of stoppered up. I've seen that for 30 years, and you know, I've seen it around now. It is what it is. It tends to go through vogues a lot like 3D TV does, or 3D movies. But I think what actually happens there, technically speaking, or you know, speaking it as a design critic, is you have innovations from computer science which are basically metaphysical, like what would happen if we could augment reality, or what would happen if we could fully mimic reality in a way that people couldn't tell the difference, which is basically a metaphysical question, like what is reality and what can we do to it with digital technology? And eventually, these guys in the lab started inventing various little innovations, which kind of pick and chip away at this metaphysical problem. And then they find out that these objects and services actually have applications, that they can be commercialized, they can be packaged, they can be distributed to consumers, and so forth. So what seems like, you know, a tremendous fountain of absolute kind of, fantastic science fiction innovation actually breaks up into a fine dust of Walmart products. And that's what is happening to augmented reality. You're finding a lot of the things that were invented to augment reality are, well, they're Pokemon objects, or they're little pop-up things that appear on your wrist, or the little isometric markers so that, you know, machines can move and deliver stuff. And there's a lot of innovations in registration technology, which is the key to augmented reality, that will end up having applications that nobody expected. The street finds its own uses for things in the classic William Gibson formulation there. So I think computer scientists will continue to like chip away at the kind of coal face of absolute reality, but what's going to work out in the marketplace and in people's daily lives are going to be small app-style pieces of stuff, right? That kind of works. And, you know, I know that sounds a bit disenchanting, but that's actually typical of what they call the technological sublime. It's like the wonder of flight, right? It's like, okay, I got here, and it took me like 3 flights, and I didn't feel any wonder. Right? And I've got to like go back in 5 days and it's going to be another 3 flights and I'm not looking forward to any wonder there either. But you know, I'm crossing the Atlantic just like Lindbergh did. And when Lindbergh crossed the Atlantic, it was a wonder. I mean, it was really a wonder. And objectively speaking, it's still as much of a wonder as it is. It's just that we're more used to it. It's simply commonplace. And I can't have my jaw drop to my knee every time I go across the Atlantic. I do it, you know, 8-10 times a year, sometimes more. I just can't maintain, you know, the level of mental stress that would, I can't believe it. But, you know, you put a 7-year-old into an aircraft for the first time and he goes up into the sky, he's awestruck. We're above the clouds. You know, he's like thrashing in his chair. He's like, it's childlike astonishment. Okay, that's an authentic emotional reaction to what's actually happening, right? But, you know, these are like questions of the human condition. There's no way that I can dress that up. I mean, there are some ways I can dress that up with a kind of sci-fi rhetoric. But you really need a kind of genuine level of sophistication and tricksterism to kind of, you know, pull out that figure ground reversal of like, the mundane is fantastic. The fantastic is mundane. There's infinity in the grain of sand. The grain of sand is the infinite. You know, it really takes a kind of poetic, formulatory power to pull that off. And, you know, I can see it done because I'm a critic. Sometimes I kind of can make a stab at it, but it's pretty tiring. And it's actually more fun to sort of get into the tall weeds and see how it works out in kind of daily life. I write less these days, but I live more, quite frankly. And, you know, to live is good, really.
Well, good. Well, that's a somewhat awe-inspiring and confusing note to end it all on, Bruce. So thank you.